name is David Aguilar. I would like to welcome you here to the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where it's always sunny and the skies are always clear. In August 2006, the International Astronomical Union took a vote. And they took a vote to see what a planet is, to try and determine if we could put a definition to it. Now, at this meeting, it was a very interesting meeting. It was loaded with props. There were umbrellas that had musical notes on them. There were blue balloons. There were packages of Country Crisp cereal and apparently a stuffed dog of Pluto. However, the question that they asked is, what is a planet? The vote that was taken with about 400 members present, which out of the 6,000 means it was similar to the state of Delaware deciding one night to vote the president of the United States. And if you weren't in Delaware that night, you did not get to vote. Now, one of the fun things tonight is we are going to get to vote at the end of our presentation as to what is a planet. Now, I've looked at this picture many, many, many times. And as I look at it, I see more and more. I see a young lady right here who seems quite smug with her vote. She's happy it's turned out this way. I see a gentleman right here that's a little upset the way he's voting. And I see another astronomer right here looking at the white paper, which appears to me to be her Verizon phone bill, which she cannot believe. But there are many arms in this room that are not voting as to whether or not Pluto's a planet. Books were written, money was made over the change of Pluto not being a planet, and full disclosure, I wrote books for National Geographic that also went into classrooms. But when I took a look at the term dwarf planet, it simply didn't make sense to me. And that's why tonight I'm hoping we can make some sense out of it. When I looked at the term dwarf planet, I asked the simple question, is a dwarf fruit tree a fruit tree? And the answer is? Is a dwarf bunny rabbit a small bunny rabbit? Why isn't a dwarf planet a small planet? Well, I had my answer. I was told by some of the people who voted that how many of you loved English? How many of you loved to diagram sentences? Both arms went up. Okay. Dwarf apple tree has an adjective modifying a noun. But the word dwarf planet is an adjective modifying an adjective. Now, the closest two words I could come to that were adjectives modifying adjectives and this one, which we all know do not come from the Rocky Mountains, nor are they oysters. So I was even more confused. What is a planet? Well, so were people across the country. Demonstrations broke out. Then the words got a little angry. Then rallies were called. Then ransom notes were received from Pluto. All about a little planet that Walt Disney named his favorite little dog about many years ago. But I noticed something very odd. I subscribe to both Astronomy Magazine and Sky and Telescope, the organs of communication for amateur and professional astronomers alike. And every month when I go into the section to see what planets are up, Pluto's there. Pluto's here. So even both these magazines are either terribly confused or they consider Pluto a planet also. When I saw what Kepler has discovered, over 1,000 confirmed planets orbiting distant stars, another 3,601 unconfirmed, I asked the question again, what is a planet? So what I decided to do was bring in three of the utmost experts in this field and let each one of them explain to us what they think a planet is and how it fits in this time period. Come on. We know what a star is, whether it's here whether it's in distant space. We know what a galaxy is, whether it's our own Milky Way or in distant space. We know what a moon is. We know what a comet is. We know what all of these things are. But apparently, we still haven't decided yet what a planet is. We live on a planet. It's right beneath our feet. Why can't we decide what a planet is in this day and age? So that's why I have asked Owen Gingerich, historian, well-renowned historian, author from Smithsonian and Harvard, to talk about the historical aspects of a planet, where the name came from, and why we considered a planet back then. I've asked Gareth Williams, associate director of the Minor Planet Center that tracks all of these objects, his view on what a planet is. And lastly, I've asked Dimitar Sasselov, the director of Harvard's planetary program, the Origins of Life Initiative, who is looking at all of these exoplanets around distant stars. So tonight, we have the wonderful opportunity to hear from the experts, and then we get to decide what a planet is. Owen Gingerich.
Thank you, David. Some years ago, the Boston Museum of Science decided to raise money for a new planetarium. And they decided to raise money by selling the sky, by selling individual stars and individual constellations. I thought that was a rather bum deal. If you bought a star with your contribution, somebody else will buy the constellation, and who's got it? So I decided I would pick a moving object like Ceres, and they gave me a deed for it. It was a quit-claim deed. In other words, they gave up all of their rights to it, to me, which I now hold. Well, this is a problem of nomenclature and how things go. The International Astronomical Union, by international consent, has an important job of naming things, naming objects in the sky, keeping track of where the constellation boundaries are, and so on. I'm here tonight to try to convince you that the International Astronomical Union does not own the word planet. So let's see how it works out. When were planets first observed? Well, probably well beyond before the time of language, certainly before the time of written language. But maybe we can find something that isn't written. For example, the Avenue of Sphinxes here in outside of Karnak is for a particular orientation of the sunset. And there are various monuments, Stonehenge and others, that go way back. This was not before writing, but it was nevertheless symbolic of that kind of thing. What about the moon? Alexander Marshak, who is a professor at New York University, I believe, looked at this, and a very ancient bone which has been inscribed, and argued that that was the pattern of the moon's motions. And if so, probably the earliest evidence we have of the behavior of the moon. Here you have an image of the stars, the starry background against which some other objects move. Planet, from Greek, means wanderer. But not all peoples recorded the heavens in the same way. Here, for example, is the Chinese way of doing it. And they use much smaller asterisms for setting up their sky. If we look elsewhere, for example, in Egypt, one of the early tomb ceilings is the tomb of Senmut, a vizier for Queen Hatshepsut. And here is a detail of it. And it's rather interesting to see that when the Egyptians recorded the heavens, they didn't put the stars in. They just had the figures. And so today, we don't really know where the crocodile is. And it's not clear if the Egyptians knew either exactly where the crocodile is, because you see they started out putting the crocodile in here, and then they didn't have quite enough space for it, so cheerfully moved it up here. So anyway, there's various ways in which you look at the heavens for the stars. But the wanderers, besides the sun and the moon, which are definitely wanderers and were considered planets for much longer than any other nomenclature system. There is here, for example, a Babylonian tablet, actually Assyrian, which records the motions of the planet Venus, which was interesting to track because of its repetition. Interestingly enough, after 8 years, you will find Venus back in almost exactly the same place. It's very unusual that way. The planet will have 13 rounds in the 8 years and come back so closely the same. So this is the oldest actual record of astronomical observations, the behavior of Venus with respect to the horizon. So you don't have to have specific stars that it's moving with respect to. The Mayans discovered this behavior of Venus, and one of the great wonderful pieces of architecture in the New World, Great palace down in Uxmal is just filled with the number 8 from Venus. Look, the bar is a 5 in the Mayan number system, and the little circles are wands. So that makes 8. And that's a decoration that you see throughout the architecture there. Here it is in the Mayan codex, part of the so-called Dresden Codex. So, again, this kind of appearance could be recorded. Venus was interesting that way, but there were other things that were also interesting, not just against specific stars, but the combinations of planets working together. So, for a long, long time, you had the planets, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, that's 5, and then Sun and Moon, 7, a magic number for a long, long time. But that all got changed in 1543. It didn't happen to convince people overnight, but in fact, it took about 150 years before the majority of educated people were prepared to accept the idea that the Earth was spinning around and moving around the Sun. After all, if the Earth spins around every 24 hours, why aren't people spun right off into space? It seemed just crazy. This is an interesting way to compute where planets are, but can you really believe this? But when people started to believe it, the Sun was no longer a planet, nor the Moon, but the Earth was. So you got this big turnaround starting in 1543. Now I started to say that one could watch for the planets coming close together. Let us say Jupiter and Saturn. Saturn goes around the sky in 30 years. Jupiter is running a race with it, so it doesn't catch up and come together until 20 years. But every 20 years, Jupiter and Saturn make a conjunction. They're together in the sky. And this is a piece, I photographed this in Vienna And I've never otherwise seen a photograph of it, so you're probably seeing this for the first time. This is some of Kepler's manuscript material in which he's working out the way in which you have this sun here, whoops, in the middle, and this is the behavior of Jupiter as it goes retrograde and then marches on, and another year later it goes retrograde again and again and again, and it goes around. And this is Saturn. And they come together in such a way that there is a conjunction, and then you get another conjunction, which is just about 120 degrees around. So you get this pattern going around. Now, a little bit of astrology for the evening. You've already had some introduction there from David Aguilar. The sky is divided up by astrologers according to the four terrestrial elements from antiquity. That's earth, air, fire, and water. As people say, the Californians have only four things to fear: earth, air, fire, and water. So the zodiac is divided up with the various symbols according to those elements. So if you, and they're spaced around so that if you have a whole bunch of them, like here and here and here, they will all be related to the same element. And at the time of Kepler, this was happening, that there was a conjunction for the first time in the fiery trigon. And then Kepler's friends came and said, "Did you see it? Here you have it with a famous constellation that I'm sure you recognize here, Scorpio, and over here is the teapot of Sagittarius, and here is the motion of the planet Mars and Jupiter and Saturn." So they were coming all together in this bunch, but what was it the friend said is so amazing? It is this brilliant new star which suddenly and mysteriously appeared in this very close connection. So this is again something that one can trace without having a specific sky background, but it was working out that way with Kepler. So let's go on past that particular pattern of motion to the astronomer William Herschel. There's his homemade telescope. He was a musician, but he was a fantastic amateur astronomer. He made his own telescope because it turned out he wasn't rich enough to buy one. And with this telescope, he discovered something amazing. He, for the first time, extended the list of planets. Here's his, from his notebooks, which are preserved at the Royal Astronomical Society in London. And you can see what here it says: in the quartile near Zeta Tauri, the lowest of the two is either a nebulous star or perhaps a comet. There we are, March 13th, 1781, and then just a few days later, I looked for the comet or nebulous star and found that it is a comet, for it has changed its place. And then, with those positions, the celestial mechanicians got going and, to their great surprise, discovered that it was way out beyond Saturn. And this was the first, in modern times, discovery of another planet. And so here you see the next, one of the next pages. Guess what? He wanted to call it after King George, Georgium Sidus. And there you can see it. Georgium Sidus appears very beautiful. So he now knows he's found a planet. Now, at this time, people had noticed there seemed to be a very large gap between Mars and Jupiter. Was there another planet that should be there? And it was predicted that there should be a planet, and a great search was started for it. But before the search team got going, they were scooped by Piazzi and Palermo, who, with this wonderful telescope, then found another moving object named Ceres. And within just a few years, three more of these objects were found, moving between Mars and Jupiter. So, the number of planets had suddenly gone up by number four. There was a gap in discoveries, and then the discoveries came in earnest. And by around 1850, there were so many, with so many symbols being adopted for them, that people said, you know, this can't go on. We can't have this many planets. We've got to call them something else. Herschel, who didn't like the idea of these new discoveries, putting his discovery of Uranus into a lower class, suggested that they should be called asteroids because they seemed so star-like. And then you got asteroids and or minor planets. Now we turn to Cambridge, England, and Paris, France. After some time, it was found that Uranus did not seem to be behaving correctly. It was as if there was some other gravitational object out there working on it, and it was proposed by John Couch Adams, a young recent graduate from the University of Cambridge, who decided after he had graduated that he was going to investigate Uranus and find out what was happening to it, and made the prediction that there should be another planet, and he in fact had a place for it. He went down to see the Astronomer Royal. The Astronomer Royal did not want to be disturbed over dinner or whatever it was, but it was agreed that where they had the telescope up in Cambridge, they should start looking for the planet. And Chalice was the astronomer there. He had some guests one afternoon, and he said, you know, we have this crazy project. We're looking for a planet, and we've mapped this huge area, and we're mapping all the stars in it so we can then look at them again and see if any one of them has moved. And, you know, it's funny, but one of them seemed to have a disk. And the visitor said, well, shouldn't we go out and check up on it? You can't do that, said Mrs. Chalice. You haven't had tea yet. And by the time they had tea, it clouded up. And the next day, the word came from Germany that the prediction, very similar by Le Verrier in Paris, had resulted in the message being sent to Germany, where they had a good telescope and an important chart of the area, and it had been discovered. Let me just show you, this is the record book, and that story, you can see the words here, seem to have a disk. It's there in the record book. And here you can see, this must have been the planet. Such sad news being scooped just that quickly. Well, anyway, here's the French view of it. There is Le Verrier, a statue in front of the Paris Observatory, and here's the cartoon of John Couch Adams discovering a new planet in the notebooks of Le Verrier. So that's the French view of it. Well, I take you now to 1930, and I want you to see how very, very tiny Pluto is. There it is. And if people had realized how really very small it was at the time, because it was hoped that the same kind of prediction process with Neptune and Uranus was leading to yet another planetary discovery. We now know that Pluto has much too small a mass to have affected those planets. They were observational or reduction errors, and so, but at the time it was very exciting. And at the time, this very building was being built, and I think some of you are aware that up around the top of the auditorium, we have these planetary symbols. And back at the far end there, in the darkness, you can't really see it, so I'm showing you the slide of it. Harlow Shapley, who is director, immediately said, we've got to get the International Astronomical Union to work to get a symbol so that we can finish the decoration of the of this room. So there it is, PL, standing for Percival Lowell, who was big in getting the search going, but was no longer alive, and standing for the letter Pluto. Here's recent pictures of it with the Hubble Space Telescope. You can see that it has some character there. So anyway, David Aguilar asks, what is a planet? And I would like to argue that planet is a culturally defined word that has changed its meaning over and over again over the ages, as you've seen. And my feeling is that in retrospect, the IAU should not have attempted to define the word planet. It is the role of an international union to define technical classes. For example, such as classical planets, dwarf planets, minor planets, exoplanets. I thought it was really dumb that the IAU took as a category dwarf planets and then said, but they're not planets. I think this is an abuse of the language, and so I was disappointed that it happened that way. The vote was on a knife edge balance, like approximately 6 votes in 400 or so votes being cast. They were given a chance then to reconsider the vote because it was statistically balanced, and they overwhelmingly voted not to vote again. Why? Because the delegates wanted to go to lunch. And so that was the end of it.
Oh, you forgot a bit.
I don't know who put that on.
All right. Okay, for those of you with a short memory, my name's Gareth, and I will be giving you the IAU view of what a planet is. It is important to note, I have to put a disclaimer in here, that this is not an official policy statement by the IAU. While I, like my two other fellow presenters, are IAU members, I am not the IAU president, general secretary, neither am I on the executive committee. They are the ones who make policy. So basically, I'm going to talk about what was the problem with planets and what was the IAU solution. Well, of course, we all know that the problem object was Pluto. The object had been predicted by Percival Lowell. He had tried to locate an extra Neptunian planet by looking at the unexplained residuals in the positions that had been observed for both Uranus and Neptune. These were rather small. It is exactly the same process that Adams and Le Verrier had used to find Neptune. He predicted it to be out at about 46 astronomical units from the Sun and to have a mass of about 7 to 8 Earth masses, a big object. That's about half Uranus, half Neptune mass. And they started a survey at Lowell Observatory using Lowell's predictions, but it was done in a very half-hearted way. They were not successful, even though in a 1915 survey they did detect the planet on two occasions but failed to notice it. It was only in 1929, with the arrival of Clyde Tombaugh, Kansas farm boy as he's described, at Lowell Observatory, that the surveying was done in a systematic way. And as we all know, Clyde took plates in a very sensible fashion, shooting near opposition, so that the motion near opposition told you roughly how far away from the sun the object was. And he took hundreds of plates. He scanned them all looking for objects moving, and he found an object near one of Lowell's predictions. Lowell made a number of predictions. Other people made other predictions, but we're just talking about, first of all, Lowell's prediction here. And it turned out to be Pluto. However, Lowell Observatory, in a quite audacious PR stunt, sent a very misleading discovery telegram to the central reporting agencies. And the key thing to pick out from this is transneptunian planet. Not an object out in the outer solar system, transneptunian planet. They were calling it a planet, supplementing Lowell's investigations. They also note that they don't actually give a position for this. They just say it's 7 seconds west from Delta Geminorum. A discovery report like this today would be laughed out of the court. You could not discover a solar system object with a report as sketchy as this. So, right from the start, they were calling it a planet. But there were problems. It was much fainter than expected. It was 15th magnitude. It was also very... It was also an outlier within the solar system. In the solar system, we have the four inner rocky planets, Mercury through Mars. Then we have the four outer gaseous giants, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. And then you have Pluto, small, presumably icy, in an orbit that is not planet-like. And Pluto seemed to shrink over the years in mass. Remember that I said that Lowell assumed it was 7 to 8 Earth masses? This is how the mass of Pluto changed over the years. Starting from 7, by just a year after discovery, they were saying, oh, it's only about an Earth mass. By the 1950s, it became a tenth of an Earth mass. With the discovery of the satellite in 1978, we knew that the mass was under 1/100 the mass of the Earth. That's less than the mass of the Moon. And we now have a very accurate mass for it. It's also, although the orbit of Neptune crosses the orbit of, the orbit of Pluto crosses the orbit of Neptune, the existence of various resonances, primarily the 3-2 mean motion resonance, means that Neptune never approaches Pluto very closely. In fact, although the orbits come within about 2.5 astronomical units of each other, the two planets, I'm using planet in the historical sense here, before somebody picks up on that in the question and answer session, can approach no closer than 17 astronomical units. In fact, Pluto goes closer to Uranus, 11 AU, than it does to Neptune. We now know that mass is 1... You missed out the 1 when you reformatted this. 1/459th that of the Earth, and we now know that Lowell's prediction was meaningless. The anomalous motion that Uranus and Neptune had with respect to the predictions of the day was caused solely by an error in a mass of Neptune. And it wasn't until Voyager 2 bypassed Neptune in 1989 that we actually got a good value for the mass of Neptune. Once we had that good mass for Neptune, all of the anomalous motion in Uranus and Neptune's motion disappeared. The only thing that was left was random observational error. So there was no object to be predicted from the observations that Lowell had. Pluto is not the object that Lowell predicted. Starting in 1977, of course, we began to discover more objects in the outer solar system. starting with 1977 UB, which became Chiron. It was followed in 1992 by the first of the trans-Neptunian objects. 1992 QB1, I remember very well the discovery report that came in, and Brian Marsden, who was director of the Minor Planet Center at the time, called me into the office and said, "I've got something very secret to show you." And he showed me the discovery report from Dave Jewett and Jane Liu, and I went, "Ooh, that's interesting." And Brian actually lost a bet because he thought it was an object out near aphelion, and that it came in much closer. And Dave Jewett bet him a bottle of champagne, I believe it was, that it was in a circular orbit out beyond Neptune. Unfortunately for Brian, Dave Jewett was right, and it became the first of the what is now known as the classical Kuiper belt. The following year, we had two objects discovered that caused us a problem at the Minor Planet Center when we were trying to calculate their initial orbits. 1993 RO, very recently numbered, and 1993 RP. They were too close. They were only at distances of about 35, 36 AU, and we said those orbits aren't stable for long periods. And then Brian again said, "Well, let's assume that they're in orbits like Pluto. Can we force them to be in orbits like Pluto?" Yes, we could. And those orbits were stable against encounters with Neptune for long periods. And so we said, okay, these are objects like Pluto. We now have more than 1,700 objects out in the outer solar system. That means essentially out well beyond the orbit of Jupiter. And of those, about 200 are in orbits that are similar to Pluto. That is, they are in mean motion resonances with Neptune. They don't approach Neptune closely. They are, to all intents, smaller Plutos. This, the discovery of these objects, and also discoveries by Mike Brown of objects like Eris, which was an object Pluto-sized, really sort of crystallized the movement that had been building over the past 70 years for reclassifying Pluto. One option that was mooted was dual status. Call it both a planet and a minor planet. That way the people who want to keep it as a planet can keep referring to it as a planet, and those of us that want to treat it as a minor planet, give it a number and stick it in the minor planet catalogues, can do so. And in fact, we were in discussions with the General Secretary of the IAU to accomplish this on the down low when news of our discussions leaked. I don't know how they leaked, but there was a violent and vehement backlash from certain sections of the planetary community, particularly in this country. And so the IAU shelved the proposal and said, we're not planning any change in the status of Pluto at this point. Chiron is an object with dual status. It is classified both as minor planet 2060 and as comet 95P, because when it was discovered it looked like an asteroid, but when it got closer to the Sun it started to look like a comet. There are about six objects that are currently dual status. So that meant that the IAU really needed to come up with a definition. The public were calling these new objects, particularly the objects like Eris, planets. The problem was that there was no IAU definition of planet. There'd never been a need to define planet before. So an IAU planet definition committee was formed. The IAU likes to form committees. I'm on a number. They can be great fun, but they can also be a lot of work. Here is the committee, all seven members, and in fact you'll recognize this dashing fellow here is, of course, Owen Gingerich, who was the chair of the committee. And they met, discussed various criteria that could be used to define a planet. They initially only came up with two, I think, and that was not rigorous enough, and so a third definition was added. So the question was, how many planets are there? Well, depending on how many you want to count them, there are the classical eight, Mercury through Neptune. You could say there are 12 by adding in Ceres, the largest minor planet in the asteroid belt, Eris, a big object in the outer solar system, and treating Pluto and Charon, its main satellite, as a twin planet. That's 12. Or you could add in another 3 objects from the main asteroid belt and another 9 objects in the outer solar system. So that's 12 plus 12, which is 24. So that's either 23 or 24, depending on whether you're counting. And I don't think we're including Pluto in any of this. So that's 24 or 25, depending on whether you want to treat Pluto and Charon as one or two planets. With the possibility, within a few decades, that we could have 50 or 100 planets. Now, I don't know about you, but school kids learning the mnemonic for remembering the order of the planets, my very educated mother just served us nachos. Do you really want to have to have a mnemonic for 50 or 100? You'd need a mnemonic to remember the mnemonic. So we really want to keep the number of planets low. So the three rules that the three definitions that the IAU came up with were that it has to be in orbit about the Sun. And the question of the double planet Pluto and Charon, planets and their satellites revolve around the barycenter of the system. For the Earth, the barycenter of the Earth and Moon is about 1,000, I forget whether it's kilometers or miles, below the surface of the Earth. But it is within the Earth. For Pluto and Charon, it's outside. If this is Charon and this is Pluto, it's out here somewhere. It's not inside the body of the planet. But even though that is the case for Pluto and Charon, it was decided that Charon still goes around Pluto. So you can still stand on Pluto and see Charon over there one time, Charon over there another time, Charon over there another time, and Charon over there yet another time. So it's going around. So for that reason, they decided not to treat it as a double object. Second, that's a rather long-winded way of saying it's spherical. That's a more formal way of saying it's round. Now, of course, you can argue, well, the Earth isn't spherical. For one thing, it's got all these bumps on it, mountains, oceans. But in general, it is rather spherical. It's an oblate spheroid because rotation has sort of flattened it. So it's about a 20-kilometer difference between the equatorial and the polar diameters. Saturn, of course, is flattened to the polar diameter, is 90% of its equatorial diameter, because that is a gaseous body and it spins very rapidly, and so the whole thing gets flattened. And the third is, and this is the point that has caused the most confusion, that the planet has cleared its neighborhood around its orbit. That is, that there are no objects in similar orbits that are stable for lifetimes that are a significant fraction of the age of the solar system that can approach the planet. So that means that the Earth, somebody said, but the Earth, there are lots of objects around the Earth. There are lots of objects around Jupiter. You've got all those Trojans. Well, of course, the objects that come close to the Earth aren't stable. They have very short dynamical lifetimes. Within 10, 100,000 years, they're not going to be there. There are no objects in orbits like the Earth that are not protected from encountering the Earth. But what about the Trojans? These are groups of minor bodies that occupy the same orbit as a planet, but orbit roughly 60 degrees ahead or behind the planet. The existence of these objects is a consequence of something called the restricted three-body problem, which basically says, in simplistic terms, that if you have two massive bodies, Sun, planet, you can have collections of massless or nearly massless bodies at positions that form an equilateral triangle. Jupiter has more than 6,000 known Trojans. The Earth has one. Mars, I think, has four confirmed or something. And although these objects move, they move around these, they're called Lagrange points, but they don't get close to the planet. So Jupiter has cleared its neighborhood. Earth has cleared its neighborhood. Ceres, which is in the main asteroid belt, hasn't. Pluto hasn't, because there are 200 known Plutinos that are in similar orbits. Dwarf planets conform to the, have to orbit the Sun and are spherical, but they haven't cleared the their neighborhoods. I've just mentioned Ceres and Pluto. The sphericity of an object can be difficult to confirm observationally, particularly for objects that are out beyond the orbit of Neptune. Anything else that isn't a planet or a dwarf planet but is orbiting the Sun is a small solar system body. This includes the asteroids and comets. Minor planet is still an acceptable term, so the Minor Planet Center didn't need to change its name to the Small Solar System Body Center in 2006. So, to summarize, a planet is in orbit around the Sun, spherical, round, and has cleared its neighborhood. And in my world, Pluto is not a planet. And I hope none of you are armed. Thank you.
My name is Dimitar Sasselov, and I'm here to talk to you about that same question from the point of view of the newly discovered, in the last 15, 20 years, exoplanets, planets orbiting other stars. Okay, so let's cut to the chase. What do exoplanets have to teach us about Pluto? Well, we already heard Pluto is a very tiny object. It is, in terms of Earth being the measuring stick, just a fifth of, or even less than a fifth of Earth's size, and just a fifth of a percent of the Earth mass. So you can compare it to the Moon. It's actually smaller than the Moon, about 30% smaller in size, and about six times less in terms of mass. So remember these numbers. And so let's ask the question now, what is the smallest exoplanet that we've managed to discover in the last 20 years? Well, how about this one? PSR 1257 plus 1215A. Well, you'll have to remember this quickly. That's the one which is, as you can see, about 10 times larger in terms of its weight, mass, than Pluto. We don't know its size, but we surmise it's about the size of the Moon. So that's an object which orbits not a star, but a pulsar. We call pulsars actually neutron stars, but they're the remnants of stars. Very exotic thing. And other than that, it's a little solar system. There are three planets in it, A, B, and C. B and C actually Earth mass planets. C is, in fact, almost two times the Earth mass. We don't know their sizes, but again, we can see and measure, we can see their presence and measure their weight or their masses by observing that pulsar, the pulsing neutron star, stellar remnant, which is in the center of that little planetary system. So if exotic objects like pulsar planets are not your cup of tea, you have to move to normal stars. But I have to tell you, my colleagues do not complain about calling planet A a planet, despite the fact that it's orbiting a very exotic object. So let's move to normal things. What is the smallest exoplanet orbiting normal star? That's actually Kepler 37b, currently holds the record. It's a moon-sized object. You can see it there. It's a little bit bigger than the Moon in terms of size. It's probably around the mass of the Moon. It orbits a normal star. It's again a system which currently has three known planets. The other two, Kepler 37c and b, bigger. C is in fact almost the size of the Earth. Kepler gives you sizes, but does not give you masses. We have to do a lot of work to get a mass. However, one thing is clear here, is that we have small planets. So, to summarize, we have reached the domain of small planets the size and the mass of Pluto. We are almost there, which is amazing when you think about the difficulties you encounter when you're searching for such small objects orbiting stars that are hundreds, even thousands of light years away from us. But let's be clear, none of these are Plutos. And particularly not so much in terms of size, but in terms of their orbits. So Kepler, mostly thanks to Kepler, I wouldn't say just thanks to the Kepler mission, but mostly thanks to the Kepler mission, has taught us one thing for sure. That is that what we think of planets, what we call planets, what we think are planets, are a very diverse lot, way beyond what we have ever seen or even imagined in our home here in the solar system. For example, there is no such thing as planets orbiting just a single star. There is Kepler 16 orbiting two stars. And we have quite a few of those now, planets that orbit more than one star. And they're very common, it turns out. On the other hand, you may have more than one planet on the same orbit. We heard about Trojans planets. We may have binary planets. We are talking here about big things, not just Pluto and Charon. Then on the other hand, we have planets which orbit tiny stars. Stars which themselves are the size of a planet, a giant planet like Jupiter. They call them dwarfs, and they're very red, as in this image here. We have quite a few of those from Kepler. And then we have planets that do not orbit a star. In fact, they're free-floating planets, little wandering planets, just repeating wandering things. We now find them. This is one of the best-known recent ones from 3 years ago, PSOJ 318. And these are sad places. They're very dark. The only light that shines on them is the combined light of the Milky Way. And they're probably very cold. What are they? They're probably ejected from planetary systems due to planet-planet interactions. And some indications, there is some evidence, show that there may be hundreds of millions of those, maybe billions of those in our galaxy. And they are out there. At the same time, we see just the opposite. Planets which are too close for comfort, essentially skimming the surface of their parent star. There is one, Kepler 78b, which was characterized thanks to a lot of effort here in this building. And that's a true lava planet. It's so close to its star that the temperature on the surface literally melts metal and rock. And we have pretty good notion of how big and how massive it is, so we know the mean density. It is a real lava planet. So you have those extremes. You have planets which are also extreme and like nothing we've seen in the solar system, but otherwise Earth-like, more or less the size and the composition of the Earth, a little bit cold, so all the water is frozen into a snowball. Currently, we don't have a planet like that in the solar system, but the Earth occasionally, for short periods of time in its history, has been a snowball, probably looking something like this. We have small bodies which are completely covered with ice. A very good example is the moon of Jupiter, Europa. But here we are talking about a snowball that also has continents, rocky continents sticking above the ice. So that's something else. And if it's a bit warmer and has a lot more water, then you end up with something which we call water planets. real water worlds, just an endless liquid ocean with skies full of puffy clouds moving around in a serene, endless water world, a true water world. We seem to have quite a few of those. And finally, then, we have those closest to what is near and dear to us, our own Earth. We call them super-Earths because, generally speaking, they are larger in size and in mass than the Earth. And Kepler seems to point out that there are plenty of those. It's probably one of the most common type of planets out there in the galaxy, a super-Earth. We even now see that some of them are of the same composition, but even bigger. Recently, we found one which is a little bit bigger than those shown here, which are from Kepler 62. And we called it a mega-Earth because it's even bigger than that. So we get surprises all the time when it comes to all these planets. And the question is, so what can we make out of this? Should we try to define what we see out there among the world of exoplanets by in origin, that is in terms of how they form? Our solar system, we know from the planets form from a disk around the star. So we have a lot of evidence that the same is true for many of the planetary systems we've already discovered with Kepler and other surveys. But we also have evidence for very weird things like PSR J171914138. That is seemingly a planet which is not a planet by origin, in the sense that it used to be a star. It used to be a star, then it stopped being a star, it became a stellar remnant, a white dwarf as we call them, a very, very, very dense quantum mechanical kind of core made of oxygen and carbon, which then was additionally stripped by its much more violent neighbor, which is currently the pulsar, the neutron star. And so now it's a planet size, planet mass object for all practical purposes, just like a planet, except it didn't start that way. And what about the free floaters, the wanderers? Do they form like stars on their own from the gas in the galaxies, or are they ejected? We know that there must be a lot of ejected planets. It simply cannot be that the formation process of planets in disks will keep all the newly formed planets in place. Some of them must be ejected. So they must be out there, and some of the free floaters are probably exactly that. So you may say, well, that's not very well defined, and in fact it's not. We don't understand planet formation well enough to do that. So forget about defining by origin. What about something simpler, just by association? Is it orbiting a star or stars? Is it orbiting a pulsar, which is neutron star remnant, white dwarf, also a stellar remnant, or actually a black hole? We see a whole bunch of stars orbiting the black hole in the center of our own galaxy, the Milky Way, very close to the black hole. We've seen them now for more than 10 years, have their orbits very well. If there are free floating planets out there in the billions, as some would think, in the Milky Way, some of those planets probably made it there and they're orbiting that same black hole. They are the black holes. So what do we call something which orbits a black hole? And what about the free floaters anyway? Are they orbiting the black hole? Well, that free floater, PSO J3018, is technically orbiting the black hole in the center of our galaxy. It's in an orbit around the center of the galaxy. The main point of mass in the center of our galaxy is a very large black hole. So I'm not very happy with any of those approaches. And so I fall down to my theoretical background and say, well, let's try to define them by physical properties. And by physical properties, then, brings me to the universe at large. That is, I'm going to try to do it in terms of what we, astronomers and physicists, have learned about the universe in which we live, the observable universe, for the past mostly 30, 40 years. What we've learned is that the universe has a fairly small number of basic structures and objects which we've been able to classify, and it is a fairly simple at very large scales. At the larger scales, you have galaxy superclusters, then you have galaxy clusters, and then you have galaxies, just like our Milky Way. And the galaxies are really an agglomerations of many stars, billions, hundreds of billions of stars, and quite a lot, usually quite a lot of gas from which new stars form. Some galaxies actually are almost free of gas, but gas is quite often part of what you see there. So what is common, what is the common thread among all those objects, which obviously neither of them are planets? Well, two things. The first thing is that they're all dominated by the force of gravity. In fact, for the superclusters, clusters, and galaxies, it's just gravity. It's nothing else. They're just set in motion, formed, and gravity rules. Stars are dominated by gravity, but there is something new that kicks in and keeps them together and what they are and makes them shine, nuclear forces. So it's gravity on one hand. The second thing, which is the common thread among all these major structures in our observable universe, is what they're made of. 99% of what you see on this slide is made of hydrogen and helium. Just hydrogen and helium, nothing else, 99%. This is what our universe is made of. That's how it started, in fact. And that 1 to 2%, which we are mostly made of, is actually an afterthought, which is thanks to that bright, shiny bottom there, the stars. The stars produce all the other elements. So, gravity and hydrogen. Gravity makes the superclusters what they are, but it's not what you see. What you see is the tracing of the galaxies and that web-like structure. What you don't see is that that web-like structure is due to dark matter. Most of the matter in the universe is dark matter, and that, as much as we don't see it, is something which we understand pretty well. We see its effect on clusters and galaxies, and we know, and that's one thing we know, is that it has little, I would say nothing, to do with stars. Stars are still dominated by gravity, but you can't make a star out of dark matter. And certainly you cannot make a smaller object, like a planet, out of dark matter. So forget about dark matter. It's not relevant to Pluto and our discussion today. But the stars are, because the stars, for the first time, bring us to this level at which gravity has a new force to counter, and that's the forces which we call nuclear forces, and which cause hydrogen and helium to transform through thermonuclear fusion into heavier elements. And that produces a lot of energy, and that energy counteracts the self-gravity of those balls of fire which we call stars. And that self-gravity continues down as you go to the lower levels, and then you have the planets. The smaller objects that are smaller in size and smaller in mass, below the size and the mass of the stars, are the planets. And they're less in mass than the stellar remnants as well, if you want to include that, and quite often in the black holes, which of course have little to teach us about this here. But they're still ruled by gravity. They are self-gravitating objects. They are squeezed by gravity. But it's no longer the nuclear forces that matter. So if I was to define what we would call a planet in this big picture, simple picture of the hierarchical structure and objects in the observable universe, it's that at the smallest scale, at the smallest things that we call planets, gravity no longer calls the shots. And hydrogen and helium are no longer the dominant composition. This is where the miracles of chemistry start to happen. And some of those planets will become living planets, just like our own. And so to me, in that big picture of the universe that astronomers and physicists have figured out over the last past half century, the planets have a very important niche, a very important place. They are those smallest lumps of ordinary matter that balance self-gravity against electrostatic forces. Below that, it's all pieces of rock, and gravity no longer matters. Above that, it's nuclear physics, and you have stars. And the other thing, which is very important to realize, is that, as far as we know, you can't have planets without stars. You can't form them. That's yet to be determined. So, in conclusion, this is a very roundabout way of me saying that I don't have a clue what the planet is. So, all I'm suggesting is that we are learning fast. We've been humbled by what we are discovering with exoplanets. And my suggestion is, let's keep Pluto a planet until we sort this out. Thank you.
Thank you, Owen. Thank you, Gareth. Thank you, Dimitar. So we've had three different views as to what a planet is. Now, isn't it intriguing, after hundreds of years of astronomy and studying the sky, something we live on is still a bit of a mystery to us? Maybe that's a good thing, because it keeps us on our toes and it keeps us studying what is out there and what is close to us also. But as we promised, we are going to take a quick little vote. It's not binding. Nothing's going to change tomorrow, except the Earth may still remain a planet. But let's find out. Let's see and take a look. So how many of you have your yellow cards? Let's begin with our first definition. And the first definition by Owen was, a planet is a culturally defined word that changes over time. In his mind, Pluto is still a planet. How many people support this? Oh, you want to? No, you can't. I'll show you the other choices then. Let's go. Planet is a spherical body that orbits the sun and has cleared its path. Pluto is not a planet. I shortened Dimitar's definition. I hope I got it right. A planet is a smallest spherical lump of matter that formed around stars or stellar remnants. Pluto is a planet at this point. All right. Now let's start again. How many people vote for number one? Good count. How many people vote for number two? How many people vote for number three?
Sorry, dear.
Oh, it is so close. I think at this moment in time, number three is the most popular vote. But as we have found, come on, take a lap. But the most beautiful thing about science that we have found is that it can change. As we make new discoveries, new information becomes part of our knowledge base, it changes and grows. And that is the most magnificent thing about how the human mind works, figures its place in this universe, how we fit into it, and how it is changing around us. So thank you for joining us here tonight. I appreciate it. We'll see you another month from the third Thursday of the month. We'll see you a month from now with another program. Thank you for joining us. Good evening.